Mini chapter 22, Herb at Home in the Westwood Village Cottage. This morning and afternoon are spent moving the incarnated amber out of the guest wing at the house on Electra Drive into a fittingly bricks and mortar home of his own, a sumptuous house on Jupiter Drive that Jaymi owns as an investment property. Amber will be free to come and go, but it's arranged that the property's housekeeper will call on him once a day to verify that all is well, treating Amber as Jamie's tenant, which, in a sense, he is. Behind the standard opacity of its frontage on Jupiter Drive, palisaded by lofty Italian cypresses, the house is positioned further back than most houses, on a hill spur, affording its rear terrace pool and its bow windows a grand lookout east and south over unspoilt slopes of semi-arid earth sprouting hardy vegetation, down the length of the neighbouring canyon and out across the LA street grid towards that clump of downtown skyscrapers at the far end of the 101 freeway's electric artery. This move to Jupiter Drive takes care of the daylight hours. For the evening hours, however, now that Jaymi has verified the locations of Dud's, Kelly's, Ashley's and Herb's homes, there will be some work for Amber to do. A home visit, to be specific. Herb first. Looking through Amber's eyes, Jaymi is exhilarated to see his own beast's hands on the steering wheel and foot on the pedal as the car purrs to a smooth halt on Lindbrook Drive in the gathering dusk. This is a tidy and attractive street in Westwood Village, lined with one- and two-storey residences and adorned with varied greenery. Amber himself might find its flavour a tad too cosy for his own tastes, but that's fine, because he doesn't live here. He resides instead, as of today, in a sumptuous property overlooking a lush canyon on the east flanks of Mount Olympus, thank you. For a normal little schlub like Herb, however, the sort of tame desirability on display here on Lindbrook Drive must be just the ticket. How sweet. What a bang-dead choice. Amber picks up a small plastic bag, gets out of the car, locking it behind him, and steps across the quiet road. Approaching Herb's home, he slips through the dimming dusk into an area of shrubbery in front and secretes himself among the foliage. He finesses his position to get the best view between the evergreen leaves. According to Jaymi, Herb always refers to his home as a cottage, and sure enough, its architecture mimics just such a country-style residence. Through the front windows, Amber can see down the length of two spacious rooms on the lower story, which are lit but unoccupied. Comfortable, messy, nothing special. Soon, the full dark of evening has descended. Seeing no further movement inside, Amber emerges from the shrubs and steps across the front garden and around the corner of the building. A light flicks on down the pathway ahead, doubtless triggered by a movement sensor. He stands for a moment, coiled in immobility. Then he turns to face the side of the house and starts to climb, as with the powerful legs of a big blonde spider, up a vertical drainpipe attached to the exterior wall, holding the plastic bag between his teeth. Through brute agility and an almost metallic strength of muscle that Jaymi has never felt before, Amber's left hand and his right hand grip the pipe in turn, helped by the grip of his feet in an animal rhythm, supporting his own weight and carrying it at relentless speed, higher and higher up the pipe, until he clambers over the gutter onto the cottage roof. Peering down over the gutter, he sees Herb emerge from a door near the bottom of the drainpipe, look along the pathway in both directions as if checking for intruders, then set off towards the front garden. Amber shimmies along the sloping roof tiles to the back of the cottage, then drops quietly onto a wide balcony. Beside him, a door stands open. Entering, he finds a large, cluttered living room with a kitchen area at one end. At the other end is a busy desk space, centred on a computer monitor displaying Herb's recent creation, Bangdead's newsfeed, with its scores and comments scrolling down in real time from all around the world. Beside the screen stands a framed photo of an onstage Herb looking comically bemused as he accepts some kind of recognition in front of the banner of some homelessness charity. A cat purrs and rubs against Amber's ankle, startling him. On the cushion of the seat is a curved indentation, doubtless where Herb was sitting until a minute ago. Somehow, this whole matter-of-fact picture of Herb as being just a guy inside his home reveals to Jaymi with greater clarity the gormless dreariness of Herb's using his skills to create something as ugly as Ain't They Freaky. With a gentle smile, Amber peels off a yellow sticky note from a pad of them on the desk, scribbles "grossest one" on the note, and sticks it onto the middle of the scrolling newsfeed on screen. He strides over to the kitchen area, opens a couple of drawers, pulls out a carving knife, and returns to the chair. He reaches his hand into the plastic bag he's been carrying, pulls out a brain, slams its moist weight down onto Herb's keyboard, then with one vicious downward thrust, he sends the knife through the brain and the keyboard, impaling both. Moisture spurts out of the organ, the keyboard emits a loud crack, and the cat dashes away. Amber steps out onto the balcony, peers down into the back garden, and waits until he hears Herb re-entering the cottage downstairs. As Herb's feet tread back up the stairs, Amber climbs over the balcony wall, hangs off the other side of it, drops onto the lawn, then vanishes down the side pathway and around the front shrubbery into the cricket chirping night on Lynbrook Drive, just in time for him and Jaymi to hear Herb's wail somewhere out behind him in the middle distance.